We've got our hands full. We know it, but I think our guys are locked in and ready to go.
All right, we'll begin here in the second row, the AP. Oh, sorry, we'll move to the first row.
Nick Kelly, Tuscaloosa News. Nate, Mowage, or Diabate, I should say, some really good minutes for you guys last game. Essentially, has he earned more playing time, or what do you think of the minutes he's done so far for you guys?
Yeah, no, he has. I mean, he's been tough, physical. His attitude's been great. You know, we always know if we put him in, we can get some toughness. So we got to find a way to get him some minutes. We like to have shooting on the floor, and that's not one of his strong suits. He was shooting well in practice today. But, you know, he's easier to pair with, like, Grant at the five, maybe, when you get, you know, then you still only have, like, one non-shooter on the floor. But, no, like, his toughness, physicality, just kind of his will to win, you know. But like, yeah, he's probably earned some more minutes, but he's got to figure out ways to get them. And, you know, based on how Reitzel is, and, you know, Reitzel's been cleared to play before and then not been able to play that many minutes. So based on Reitzel, even if he can play, if he doesn't play that many minutes, there's going to be some minutes available for Mo to be able to pick up.
We'll go next to the third row.
Hey, Ryan Hennessy, NBC 13 in Birmingham. Two, if I could. First one, today was the day 5 years ago that you were announced officially as the head coach of Alabama. To look back and just kind of talk about your 5 years and how special it's been, obviously the contract extension, and what's this meant to not just you but your family.
I didn't even realize that March 27th it was, huh?
You were announced that day, and then you were introduced the day after, I believe.
1 week after my oldest daughter's birthday. She didn't like the wasn't a very good birthday present for her to move her from Buffalo to Alabama, but it's turned out to be pretty good. She loves in Alabama now. Lexi's a sophomore at the university. Lexi and Jossie will be here for the game tomorrow. We've come to love Alabama. And I think we've gotten the program turned around. I think, you know, we've been able to do what Greg hired us to do. Let's get this basketball program on a national level like about every other sports program at Alabama is. So we still haven't gotten to a Final Four. That, to me, that's kind of the next step. So got to win tomorrow to get a chance to win another game to get to the Final Four. So, you know, making a Final Four is not easy. You got to beat some good teams. You got to upset some teams. So, you know, we've somebody gave me a good stat the other day. I think there's been four teams in the country that have been in three out of the last four Sweet 16s. And I think this is accurate. I think it's us. Gonzaga, who's made like nine straight, which is crazy. It's us, Gonzaga, Houston, who we had a series with, and then Creighton. So pretty good company. I think over the 5 years since we were hired, we've gotten this program to a level that it's what Alabama sports should have their athletics at. Now we got to make another step. So we got to get this team locked in. Really ready to go against Carolina, but you know, I'm super grateful to Greg and Dr. Bell and Chancellor St. Jean and the whole board. They've been super supportive. I'm appreciative that they gave me a new contract and want to keep me around in this business. Sometimes they don't want to keep you around very, very long, but I think we've done well enough that they want to keep us here and keep this thing rolling.
And my second one is we were out there, I believe it was 2 years ago, in San Diego. When you see Cormac Ryan, I know you mentioned it, but oh boy, yeah, that was
That was not one of our better NCAA tournament games. He killed us. I think he was 7-9 from three. I think he scored 29 points on us. You know, that was the game that Quinterly blew his ACL out in the first couple minutes, so that it didn't. He was playing really well. It didn't go well for us. I think that was the only time I've been at Alabama that we haven't made a Sweet 16 that they've had an NCAA. A tournament, so you know they didn't have the tournament my first year with COVID, and then these last 4 years we made a Sweet 16 three out of those years. That was the one. So we tried to recruit him when he went in the portal. If a kid destroys you like that, it'd be good to add him to the roster. We were not successful in our recruitment of him. He picked another pretty good basketball program, and here we are. So we got to try to figure out how to stop him a second time.
But
Hi, Coach. Nikki Kay with Spectrum Networks. First of all, happy belated birthday to your daughter. But you're back in the Sweet 16 with three returners from last year, and you're facing a program that's got a unique blend of experience and talent. So when you look at these two teams, what do you think it is about the composition of players that helped you guys get to this point in this landscape?
Yeah, I mean, we had three returning players from last year, so it's not many, but we're in the transfer portal era where that happens. You know, I think those three guys got good experience, you know, Mark and Rylan and Nick. Then we were able to add in some really good freshmen that have contributed. You know, we talked about Mo Diabate earlier and Jaron Stevenson, who's from Chapel Hill, so this is a little bit of a meaningful game for him. You know, Sam Walter's been good for us. You know, those three guys. And then we were able to add some transfers that have really helped keep this program at a pretty high level. You know, Estrada's kind of been that do-it-all guard that's been great for us, had a triple-double. Grant's been good for us. Reitzel's been really good for us. You know, I think we got a pretty good mix of a lot of new guys in to keep this program up to where, you know, we're not the number one overall seed like last year, but you don't get Brandon Miller every year either. So thought we got some pretty good replacements in to keep us at a pretty high level to where we're in a Sweet 16 and got a shot to make the second. You know, Alabama's only been to one Elite Eight ever, and that's the farthest they've ever gone. So if we can win one more game, we kind of equal that and then give ourselves a shot to try to make the first Final Four ever there.
Go ahead. We'll go to the third row here.
Coach, do you talk to Pringle and just say, this is the game? I mean, you got one of the best big men he's going up against. Is this the game where he can really show himself? He showed himself a lot last week, but this is kind of the game to bring you guys to the Elite Eight.
Yeah, I think Nick's been great, like, in the NCAA tournament. Leadership, effort, intensity, focus. You know, when he's that way, he's good. I had a meeting with all of our bigs shortly at the first film session we had in Carolina and kind of made the point to them, listen, we've played some of the best bigs in the country. That's great that we put a schedule together that you guys were able to test. The issue is we haven't done all that well. I mean, we had Nick and Wage foul out, both of them foul out three straight games. They said we got to be able to guard the big without fouling and keep you guys in the game, do a better job. So I expect those guys to kind of lock in the film study, be a little better. I think Nick's been great for the last week. You know, he's battling a foot injury, but at this point of the year, if you're fully healthy, probably means you're not playing any minutes. So like everybody's banged up a little bit at this point of the year. So I think he'll be ready to go, and I think his mindset's right. Now, I mean, Baycott's one of the best bigs in the country, so we could do pretty well, and Baycott could still have a decent amount of points. I mean, I think he scored over 2,300 points. It's a lot of points in his career, so he's a pretty good player.
Go ahead in the back.
Sports. Coach, you know, it's been discussed, you know, locally, but you didn't lose a lot of players. You didn't only lose a lot of players. You lost three assistants at this time last year to head coaching opportunities. I'd just be curious what last April was like for you. And, you know, now that you're on the other side, if you ever envision that this group, as you're making phone calls and doing all this stuff, could be in this position, obviously, third Sweet 16 in 4 years.
Yeah, it was great in some regards because you get to see your three assistants that have been with you for 4 years get the opportunity to go be their own head coach, which is why, you know, kind of the ultimate goal of assistants. So you're really close to Brian, Charlie, and Antoine. They've kind of been in the wars with you for 4 years, and now they get to run their own programs. So super happy for them. But, you know, maybe not all at the same time. So, you know, like, if it comes up, we're the number one team in the country, so that helped. So, you know, we've got a saying there, when the tide rises, all the boats rise. We use it with the players, trying to get them to realize when you win, you all get taken care of. But it applies to the staff, too. So while I was really happy, it did cause some stress. So, I Charlie and Brian had their jobs, and then the day that Petway got his, all of a sudden I realized, like, I have no assistants left anymore. So, you know, we started to make some hires. I had made, you know, talk to Coach Pannone a little bit, but he still had the NBA season going. Talked to a couple other guys in the NBA that maybe wanted to get into college. I'd talked to Preston. We had to sort through some issues on him. And then, you know, I'd interviewed a handful of guys when I'd been at the Final Four myself, and all of a sudden I'd start to make some decisions. I'm at zero. You know, I would, at least till Antoine got it, I had one. So to have zero assistance and then realize that you've got to replace all these players, we got to get going here. So, you know, the hiring process, you know, when Pannone said he wanted to do it, that's great. You know, he still had to finish the NBA season. Preston had to wait till his show cause was up. So I got Claunch in, who had been a head coach, and I think he did a really good job kind of helping hold it all. I think I did a pretty good job with the hiring. And now I got to go hire some more, you know, because Claunch already got a head job again, which is great because he deserves it. So I think to put the roster together that we did speaks volumes to the staff, to our system, to be able to hire the guys in that I did speaks to the level of basketball we've got in this program too. But, yeah, we only had three returning players and no returning assistant coaches. So that's – now – you're able to put two more guys on the floor, not recruit. So Bowman's been with me for a while, so we were able to at least have some continuity with a guy on the floor that's been with me. But, yeah, I think our staff's done a great job. I think we did a pretty good job hiring, and the administration was great in helping me hire the right guys and keeping this program up to a pretty high level.
All right, we got time for one more. Go ahead in the back.
Cameron Salerno, CBS Sports. I know you mentioned earlier that you guys played one of your best defensive games in a while. How do you guys balance that and maintain that level of defensive intensity while also, you know, maintain the top scoring offense in the country as well?
Yeah, I told them we don't have to forget about offense when we play great defense. You can put both together. So the Grand Canyon game, I've had people compare it to a rugby contest, football contest. It got a little rough, physical. I like the fact that our guys matched their physicality and we stayed in it and didn't quit and showed a lot of character. But, yeah, it'd be nice for our offense, you know, to take care of the ball and make shots like we've been. So we're going to need both. I think I honestly, in the past, have felt like when we've played our best defensive games, you know, with other teams, even this team, then you can get out and transition more when you're getting stopped. So a great defense should help your offense in theory. Now, again, when it was as physical as it was and, guys had to get used to the officiating and what was going to be called, what wasn't going to be called, that might have had some effect on the offense. I think North Carolina is a pretty physical team, though, too, which, you know, they've got a pretty good defense. So, we've got to get our offense back. We know that. We're not going to be able to hold Carolina to 60 points. It's not really who we are, and that's definitely not who they are. So, you know, we're going to have to get an offense that's clicking like the number one offense in the country in order to have a chance to win this game. So we've made that point. We're putting a little more time in on our offensive side, trying to figure out how to attack them. Now, they're not easy to figure out how to attack because they've got really good rim protection. They got good guards. They've got smart players. They're good. But we are putting some time in on our offensive side of the ball, too.
All right. Thanks, Coach.